Thanks for coming, and today is my first time organizing an event like this, so I'm nervous here. So today I'm going to talk about experimenting with architecture for Android. So a little bit introduction about myself. So my name is Tan Jun Rong, and people find it hard to remember, so people just call me JR. Is similar to the training company, the RVs, so people can handle that way. I came from Malaysia. I'm an Android engineer looking for a codepad. I have a little bit of experience in C, and then I worked on Ruby, and I have a little experience on Rails as well. And I started out doing Android, so I learned Java, and eventually we adopted Kotlin, so poof, off. It goes for Java, and I use more Kotlin now. And I'm also available at GitHub. So this is my GitHub page, and my handler is worker8. So today, let's talk about architecture. So the first question here is, why do we really need it? You can write like 1,000 lines of code, and the app is still going to work. When I first started out programming, my focus is to get the stuff to work, and I don't care about architecture, I don't care about tests, my focus is going to work. But somehow, after I programmed for another few years, I realized that this is not the way to go, because bugs are flowing in and the app gets really hard to maintain. So let's take a look at an activity, so we need something to discuss about. So let's say you're implementing a login activity, and at first your boss tells you that, oh, you just need Facebook login, because Facebook is the most widely used one. And later on, they say, oh, we also want like Google login, and they add one more. And slowly, poof, you have more and more, and the activity becomes really long, and it can easily get like count 1,000 lines. And initially, this is a real example. In the Codepad app, we have like 1,000 lines login activity. So it's really hard to maintain. So this is some disadvantage of using GNOME architecture. So everything is very highly coupled together. And when you want to swap out a view, I believe that you have seen some UI where you have, let's say, a list view, and sometimes there's a button there where you can switch it to a grid view. If you want to do stuff like that, switching the view, it's very difficult to do that, because everything is bundled in one big activity. I'm not sure if everyone is an Android developer here. So activity is like the main controller of the app. I believe it's called like controller for iOS, I'm not sure. And it's pretty hard to swap out the data source and the main logic. Yes. So it becomes really long, and it's very hard to test. And you can only test with Expresso. And Expresso, if you're not familiar with Android framework, Expresso is a testing framework. It's an integration test for Android. So it's like simulating user click. And I believe there are more disadvantages. So in Android, when you say about no architecture, it means that it's MVC, model, view, and controller, and everything will be bundled inside one file. The only way to test it is like this. Call it from outside, and then check the output that it emits. So I hope that you're convinced that we really need to put an architecture in place so that the code is more testable. So now we need to choose an architecture. So when I started out learning about all this architecture stuff, I Googled up, and I find that there are so many of them: MVP, MVVM using data binding, MVVM using RxJava, Uncle Bob's clean architecture. I'm like, oh no, it's too hard. And I realized that there's an official one from Google, and they actually implemented the same exact application using various different architecture out there. So, and I started looking into it, and I find that there are even more than I imagined. But we need to take it slowly. So I will start with the most common one, which is MVP. So today's discussion will be MVP, two different ways to do MVPM, and I will add in one more that this is, I named this myself, we kind of come up with a weird architecture, I guess. I will briefly talk about that too. So again, we need an example so that we can make comparison. So let's say we have a standard form, which is asking for the name and the favorite animal. And when we key in the name, my name is JR, so JR, and it's going to generate an output saying like JR likes dog and cat. Here is an example. So what's important here is like as I type, the output changes itself. There's no button for that. So let's see how we can implement this with no architecture at all. So it's pretty simple here. So the name edit text, which is the first input when I have key in something, I store this as name, and then I call update because I want every keystroke triggers the update. Same for the animal, and finally, it's a bit low over here, but this is the method which update the string down there. So let's discuss a little bit about the testing strategy. Again, as I mentioned, you can only call it from outside because everything is bundled together. You call it from outside and you see what output it means. You verify against that. I think this is not good, so let's take a look at MVP. I still put that over there so that you can refer to it. So in MVP, notice that previously I was calling another method under this because every time I store the name, I call the update. But now I shove everything inside into the presenter, so like I only call the presenter the onMain change when inside the listener. And let's take a look at the presenter. So in the presenter, we are doing the same thing as before, but notice that now my activity is more clean because it's shorter. But you might argue that, oh, but you meet this presenter and you're writing even more code actually. So, but you will see the advantage when we discuss about the testing strategy. So again, you can still use Espresso, which is an integration test. Go outside in, click on key in some input and look at the output. But now we have another option. Now we have this option, which is to use JUnit test and test against the presenter directly. So you can actually cancel this platform. A little gray text over there to indicate that you don't actually need to test this. Of course, integration test will still simulate a user click better because it's, something might still go wrong at this site if you just daily test the presenter. But I guess it's good enough because integration test is very long, and when you get some error, it's very hard to tell like which part gone wrong. And this is actually a pretty simplified version. So you might be wondering why it's like many things missing. So it's answered over here. This is like a more practical use case. Usually the data doesn't just come from the inside because if you look at this screen, the model is bundled inside the presenter. But in actual case, usually it comes from the network. So it will be something like this. So imagine if you JUnit test the presenter and you cut this part out, and you can actually JUnit test a service and you can supply like fake data inside for the presenter to use. Or you can even set up a mock server and reply fake data to yourself if you're using like HTTP, which is a famous HTTP client. So this is the beauty of separating stuff into module. so that stuff are not coupled together, so you can test them, you can swap them around, you can use real test. So let's recap the advantage of MVP. So you can test the state of the screen without using Espresso, and the tests become really lightweight. And code-wise, everything is decoupled, and it improves the readability. And if there's new member coming in, there is a consistency over there, because we know that where we put stuff, if it's coming from network, we put it in repo or service, depending on your naming. And we can swap module around easily. Next, let's compare this to what we have. So this is the standard MVP that I talked about, and this is MVVM. Realize that the only difference here is that these two are binded together. I realize that there's no such word as binded because it's bound. It underlines my binded when I try to do this down. So they are bound together. And what it means by it is bound together is like when you have a model. So over here, your output is this line. These two are the input. So for the output, it will be bound to the view. This can be done by two ways, which is RxJava or data binding. So when you update the output, the view will get reflected directly. And I realized that when I'm doing the example for MVVM, I refer to some notable blog posts, and this is one implementation, and I realized that we are saying that in view model, and is doing the responsibility of the presenter. So I start to wonder, like, is this the correct implementation of MVVM? Because like, why is MVVM doing what presenter is doing? So slowly I realized that presenter and the so-called view model, they actually share the same responsibility. And then I check against the origin of MVVM, which is coming from Microsoft. This is a diagram taken from the Microsoft website. And I realized that this is the key over here. We are saying that view model consists of state and operations. What it means is operations is which is what presenter is doing. So it is actually sharing what presenter is doing. And plus another thing is carrying the state of the view. So MVVM versus MVP. So they look really the same. But wait, view model has something different. Consider this in my previous example. I'm setting up a string, which is like jr likes dog and cat. So comparing MVP and MVVM, this is the two different way that I set it up. So realize that in the view MVVM case, I set the display string directly, and then it will automatically get reflected on the view because they are bound together by some libraries. For the case of presenter, we are delegating the responsibility to the view itself. Yeah, so this is the key difference. They're bounded together. So this is what a view model actually means. It means that it covers operations and it also covers the states. So let's discuss about the testing strategy. It's not too different from MVP. So you can see we can still use JUnit to test the view model. But however, the difference is that we can test on the view model state directly instead of testing on the method call. So as I mentioned, there are two ways of doing MVVM. So in MVVM, the only difference is data binding. So as long as we can do the data mining, this MVVM. When data mining library appeared coming from Google, MVVM started to become famous in the Android sphere. But it doesn't necessarily mean that you can only achieve MVVM using data mining. You can also actually do it using RxJava. So let's consider the difference. Personally, I used RxJava before trying out the data mining library from Google. This is my opinion, so don't take it as like a for sure thing. You can try it out yourself. I find it very hard to use because it bundles logic inside XML, and you cannot test if you have stuff like that inside the XML. XML is the view for Android, and it's really hard to test. And if you don't draw a boundary, you can easily stuff a lot of stuff inside here, and this gets really long. And it's, you can only use Espresso to test it again. And oh, sorry. And in fact, RxJava provides more because it can help you to manipulate strings. And also, if you're using data mining library, they have classes called the observable. And the observable from data mining library is very different from RxJava. So although the name is the same and they do almost the same thing, but they are completely different stuff. So if you want to count the two of them together, you need some manipulation and it's easily confused. This is some stuff I don't like about the library. And if you're interested in this topic, you can just Google for this term. Android data mining library, bad idea, and you can read more. Maybe you think this is wrong, but you can try it out yourself. And if you do it using the RxJava way, it is recommended to do it in RxJava way if you are already using RxJava. So that, because first you will need to learn it again, and the observable, and you don't have the observable confusion issue coming from two different libraries, and there's no spaghetti code inside the XML. Besides that, you can do more of course, manipulating strings. This is like how the sample code will look like. This is how you bound the view model with the view itself. So let's take a look at the advantage of MVVM. I would say that the rest, this part is the same as MVD, so I'm not going to repeat. So the only key difference for me is instead of dealing with the view itself, you deal with view model. And you just assume that the view model is bound together with the view. So in my opinion, I like MVVM more. Because instead of checking the view dot action, you can test on the view state directly from the view model. For me, the disadvantage would be having to learn data mining library, but I think this is remedied by RxJava. So how should I choose? I would advise to test it out yourself before choosing. And also remember, this is the most important part of choosing. I would say you need to focus on the problem that you wanted to solve. Not because this architecture is really cool and you need to use it. Don't focus on the solution, focus on the problem you want to solve. So for really trivial app, if you're just doing something like me, a problem with two input and one output, don't use any architecture at all because you are going to get it done in few minutes. But if your project, you have a decently big project which is using, say, RxJava, I would advise to use MVVM. Otherwise, just use MVVM. So for today's discussion, I've covered three of them. And so what is this? This is something that we don't see if you find it, because I just mean it as I do this presentation. So let's take a look again at this. Oops. Let's recap a little bit. So in the MVVM case, we have a view model, and this is the responsibility of view model, the states, plus the operations. So what if we take away the operations and we put this back to presenter, because presenter is the guy who is actually responsible for the operation. So just put it back to presenter. And now that view model only hold the states of the view. So how is it going to look like? So it's going to be like this. So as you can see, we separate out the view model is turning back into presenter because we are separating the state out like this. So that's how I come up with the name of MVP VM. I don't like this name, to be honest, but I think this is what people will understand. So yeah, maybe like this. So what difference does it make? Why do I need to separate them? Again, when we start to separate the responsibility, we can do something really different. For example, so currently now, this state will become the new model, so I put the VM over there. And what you can do differently is now you can persist this state. This is something very important. So what does it mean by persist? So let's say this is the app you're working on. This is a snapshot of the view at this point of time. Note that the send button is currently disabled and there's nothing written over here. It's empty. This is one snapshot. And then you have another snapshot over here. Notice that when I type something, the send button is enabled. So this is the beauty of separating the state out. So if you have more and more stuff, you have a series of state. And sorry, I'm really bad at this. If you have a series of state, now that if you want to save this, you can save this to your DB, and you have all the snapshot of the things happening in time. So you can actually let's say you want to save this as a draft. There's no issue of doing that because you can just save this state, and when you restore it, the button is going to be enabled and the ASDF is going to be there. So this is a peek at how we implement it. Note that I'm making a new snapshot every time. So this is when it's empty, this is when I key in more stuff and even more stuff. So we have a series of snapshots like this. So this is very useful. This is the recipe editor page of CodePad. So since we are trying to expand globally, so some of the countries we don't have a good connection. Even in countries that have good connection, you might get disconnected sometimes. So offline editing is very important. To achieve that, you need to save the whole snapshot of the screen. So if we model our architecture in this way, we can actually save it easily. So what's beyond that? Can we do even more? Let's say we have a series of states. Since we have all the states, if we save all this, can we replay them like back and forth? The answer is yes, but it's not quite yet. We need a contract because we need to limit the ways we mutate the view model, and we need to make sure that there's no side effect. If this is foreign to you, that's fine because this is the concept of Redux. I myself is starting to learn this. So I think this is a very good tutorial from the creator of Redux. We can actually model this in Android, because if you think about it, Android, iOS, front end, all of them are doing the same. Is serving as a client, so we all share the same problem. So actually, Kitty Nan, the previous speaker, he made a very awesome example project over here. So this is just a very simple counter app just to portray the idea of this Redux thing. So as you click increment, this is going to be added, and when you click increment, this is going to be decreased. And you make an Android plugin over here. This is actually the Android Studio, like the right side of it. And you have a little timeline over here. So you can actually go back and forth. I'm going to play it's a GIF. So now hitting increasing and decreasing. As you can see, we make snapshot every time. And now you can jump back and forth. Blocking it, sorry. Why is this important? It's because if you have a fixed way to replay everything, if you capture this, and if you, let's say you have a crash, to send this log report to somewhere else, to your log server, and you are able to replay the whole thing, and you wouldn't be able to have trouble like, oh, how is this crash came along, because you don't know how it happened. If you have this, you can replay, oh, and you can see finally how the user get to the point of the crash. And Hitinan also actually make another example, which is a to-do list app, a very simple one to showcase how we model our app into the Redux way. And this is available in GitHub. It's a very simple app with a filter. This is just a showcase app. So the link is here, example of doing the Redux thing. This is the full link. And just now I mentioned about MVP, MVVM, and tons of other architectures. It's all inside here. And I'm still working on it, so don't take the code. Don't be too picky on the code. So what else is out there? So if you look up architecture for Android, there's another one called Uncle Bob Screen Architecture. This Redux thing I just talked about is from front-end developer, and there's this Viper thing for iOS, which I haven't had time to look into it. I think the only difference is that Viper is having a navigator, but I'm not sure because I haven't looked into it. And thank you, that's the end of my talk. Arigato gozaimasu. To fill up this survey, it's gonna make our meetup more awesome the next time. Hope you enjoy tonight. Thank you.
Great talk, by the way. I want to ask you one question, which is do you find any bad points of using architecture? Let's say we thinking about what is the bad point of applying architecture to the app. Do we see any bad points at all?
I would say the overhead is very hard to learn. And the more benefit the architecture brings, is usually harder to learn, in my opinion. Because at the beginning, if you look at it, the most simple one would be MVP. Basically, you pull stuff out from very long file, and it actually creates another longer file, something like that. And next, I talk about MVVM, which is in a layer addition to that, which is to bind data together. And that is another thing for you to learn, to how to bind data together. And next, I talk about the Redux thing, which is even more complicated. I'm still even doing it now. So I guess that's the downside.
Thank you.
Hello. I'd like to ask, you explained about the MVP, VM, and points regarding data binding and etc. But these days there are a lot of libraries coming out like Firebase, which provides real-time database and things like that. How do you compare them with, you know, learning everything from scratch, trying to implement your own architecture versus directly using a library plugin like Firebase, which does everything out of the book? So I don't know if you've tried something like that before, a real-time database which takes care of all the bindings on its own. Have you tried it?
I have not tried it, but
okay.
Are you talking about the database?
Yeah, like how you mentioned, it's quite difficult. The overhead is too high to learn and implement your own MVP VM architecture. Compared to that, if you use some libraries, like Google came out recently with Firebase real-time database, which kind of does everything out of the plugin itself. So if you try it and you realize that, you know, it's kind of making things easier, would you still prefer reinventing the wheel and trying to create your own efficient MVP VM architecture, or would you rely on a third source plugin?
I haven't used the library that you mentioned, so I couldn't answer to that, but I will change the question a little bit. So maybe it's like, if there's an established architecture that is made into a framework versus a framework that you come up with yourself.
Yeah, so that's kind of my question, yeah.
Oh, okay. So, in my opinion, if you have a framework, of course it's good to use it if you agree on the benefits that it brings, and the overhead, you can bear with the overhead, because it's going to force you to do it in that way, that particular way. So in just now my example over there, you can still implement it in like say the Redux way or the MVP VM way, but it's easily gone wrong because there's no restriction that is restricting you from doing elsewhere. You can still go forward and do the no-up architecture way because there's no restriction. So if there's a framework that is helping you to cut down all the boilerplate and also to enforce the restriction for you, then it will be great. It will be better to use it. But of course, if you come up with a customized one, it's going to be more fitting to your specific problem that you're trying to solve, I guess.
Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. Is there any like nice plugin or something to auto-generate some MVP or MVVM code in Android Studio environment?
That's a good question. I think there's some framework out there that you can extend from for MVP and like maybe for other stuff. But I haven't looked into that, so I couldn't answer your question. You really need to look up. But I agree that there's a lot of boilerplate that we can cut down by generating.
Thank you.
Yeah. I guess if you have any question, you can talk offline. Yeah, thank you for coming again.